Hi, everyone. I'm Pastor Rick at Tunnel and Warren Chapel United Methodist Churches outside of Marietta, Ohio. And I'm so glad you could be with us here on March 28th of 2021. Today is Palm and Passion Sunday, which kicks off Holy Week leading up to Easter on next Sunday, April the 4th. This upcoming Thursday is Holy Thursday, which falls on April 1st, and we'll observe at 7 p.m. with an online service focused on the events of Jesus' last meal with his disciples. Then Friday is Good Friday on April the 2nd, when we'll remember Jesus' crucifixion. We'll mark this with an online service of darkness with a time of meditation at the cross. And we invite you virtually to join us this week for these services and next week on April 4th for our Easter celebration on the most important day for Christians marking the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Today we will start with a joyful entrance into Jerusalem and end at the cross with someone else who was there when Jesus was crucified. So give thanks to our God, whose goodness and mercy endure forever, who answers our cries, who sustains the weary with a word, who takes human form to stand with us. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord, and blessed are we when we stand with him. At home, you can stand up and march as we sing this next hymn. And since you probably don't have any palm branches with you, raise the palms of your hands in the air and wave them in celebration of Jesus as we sing, Hosanna, loud Hosanna, Hosanna, loud Hosanna. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, you've come in God's name and for our sake. You have entered our souls in moments of shouted hosannas and waving cloaks. And you have come just the same to our late nights and to our confused hearts. Come to us again, dear one, and let us follow you. Let your name be on our tongues and in our hearts. Amen and amen.
O'er all the way, green palms and blossoms gay are strewn this day in festive preparation when Jesus comes to wipe our tears away. throng to welcome him prepare. Join all and sing his name declare. Let every voice resound with joyful acclamation. Hosanna, praise ye the Lord. Let him who cometh to bring us salvation. His word goes forth and people by its might. Once more their freedom gained from degradation. Humanity doth give to each his right. While those in darkness are restored the light. Join all and sing his name declare. Let every voice resound with joyful acclamation. Hosanna, praise ye the Lord. Bless him who cometh to bring us salvation. Sing and rejoice, O blessed Jerusalem. Love all thy songs, sing the emancipation. Through boundless love, the Christ of Bethlehem brings forth a hope to thee forevermore. Join all and sing his name declare. Let every voice resound with joyful acclamation. Hosanna, praise be the Lord. Bless him who cometh to bring us salvation.
Hey kids, it's so wonderful that you're here with us as we celebrate Palm Sunday. Now I want you to participate with me today as I talk with you. And you adults can join in too. What I want you to do is every time you hear the word celebrate or celebration, I want you to cheer and wave your hands in the air, the palms of your hands, like this. Yeah. Yay! Yay! I really enjoy a great celebration. Yay! Don't you? What are some things people like to celebrate? Yay! A birthday party? A holiday? A sporting event? How do they celebrate? Yay! Well, one of the ways people celebrate, yay, is making a lot of noise. And this morning, let's have a celebration. Yay! Let's celebrate. Yay! That we're here together by computer and TVs to worship and to praise Jesus. Let's give three cheers for Jesus by saying, hip, hip, hooray, three times. Are you ready? Here we go. Hip, hip, hooray, hip, hip, hooray, hip, hip, hooray. Wow, that was great. And I think this is a good day for us to celebrate. Yay! Because Jesus is very... Celebrate Jesus because today is a very special day. Today is Palm Sunday. It's when we remember how people celebrated. Yay! When Jesus entered in Jerusalem on Sunday around 2,000 years ago. You may have already heard the story, but let me tell it again. Jesus was walking with his disciples towards Jerusalem, and as they came near to the city, Jesus told of his two of his disciples to go ahead into town. He told them that they would see a young donkey tied there that had never been ridden. Untie the donkey and bring it to me. If anyone asks you what you're doing, tell them, the Lord needs it, and he will send it back to you soon. And the disciples did what Jesus told them to do, and it happened just as he had told them. They found the young donkey, untied it, and started to lead it away. Some men were standing nearby, and they said to the disciples, where are you taking that young donkey? And they told them what Jesus had said, and the men let them take the donkey. And Jesus, excuse me, and the disciples brought the young donkey to Jesus, and they put their coats on it to make a soft place for Jesus to sit. And as they made their way into the city of Jerusalem, people went ahead of Jesus shouting, "Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." Others followed behind, and they were also shouting, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Hosanna in the highest!" And all the while, people lined the streets cheering and waving palm branches. It was this wonderful celebration. Yay! As people cheered loudly for Jesus. And just as those people celebrated, yay! 2,000 years ago, we have tuned in today to celebrate, yay, Jesus. What better day to do that on than on Palm Sunday? The Bible says, "This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it." Let us pray. Dear God, we celebrate today just as those people celebrated in Jerusalem 2,000 years ago. This is the day that you have made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. It was great having you with us today, kids. And I hope you can join us next Sunday on Easter Sunday. Have a blessed week. Throughout Lent, and as we begin Holy Week here on this Palm Sunday, it's appropriate to imagine prayer as being cross-shaped and relational. The vertical line signifies our relationship with God. Prayer's a time to build that relationship in the midst of that relationship, prayer's a time when God can do his transforming work in our lives. But only if we allow for God to do that. If we allow time for God to speak to us and instead of monopolizing the conversation, and as we yield to his will instead of insisting on our own way, let us open ourselves up to God, yielding to him as we practice listening to God during this next week of Holy Week. The horizontal bar represents our relationship with others. Prayer is a time when we can intercede for our family, we can intercede for our friends, and even our enemies. We can lift one another up and in our needs and their needs up to God, and also praise God for answered prayers and blessings. Not just for ourselves, but for others also. And if you have a need to be lifted up or a praise to share, you can call me or you can text me at 740-304-5133. Again, that's 740-304-5133. Or you can email me at PastorRick@TunnelUMC.org. Again, that's PastorRick@TunnelUMC.org. And if you request it, I'll share it with our prayer warriors, and they'll pray with you and for you also. Otherwise, if you don't request it, I'll keep it between you and me and God and whomever else you share it with. Jesus willingly submitted to suffer in our place. So let us pray to God our Father and place in his hands the suffering of the world. There will be a period of silence for your prayers after each petition, which I'll conclude with, "This is our prayer," and you'll respond praying, "Have mercy on your people, Lord." We pray for the church, that we may bear our cross and follow Jesus. This is our prayer. Have mercy on your people, Lord. We pray for those who have sinned, like Peter. Teach us to be sorry for our sins and forgive us for Jesus' sake. This is our prayer. Have mercy on your people, Lord. We pray for prisoners and criminals like Barabbas, and for the two that were crucified next to Jesus. May they find true freedom by changing the way that they live. This is our prayer. Have mercy on your people, Lord. We pray for people in government like Pilate. May they be responsible and serve truth and justice. This is our prayer. Have mercy on your people, Lord. We pray for those who are dying, like the thieves who died with Jesus. May they die with Jesus by their side and be received into your kingdom. This is our prayer. Have mercy on your people, Lord. We pray for parents like Mary who have lost a child. May they bear their suffering and know the comfort of your love. This is our prayer. Have mercy on your people, Lord. We pray for the whole human race. We pray that all may come to know Jesus as their Lord and their Savior. This is our prayer. Have mercy on your people, Lord. And Father, may the suffering death and that suffering and death of Jesus lighten the burdens of all who suffer. Lead us in the way of the cross, so as we suffer with Jesus, we may rise to life in his glory. For he lives and he reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God now and forever. And now we pray as Jesus taught his disciples to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen and amen.
The burden of my heart rose. repay the debt of love I owe. Here, Lord, I give myself away. 'Tis all that I can do. At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day.
Are you familiar with that term, dead man walking? It's a term used for condemned prisoners who are on death row. They've been condemned to be executed. Their time is set, their time is limited, and when they take the prisoner out of their cell and they're walking him towards his execution, the other prisoners yell out, "Dead man walking!" Because they know that every step that that prisoner takes is one step closer to his ultimate death. When it's a dead man walking, there is no hope of being saved. That's a dead man walking. Let me introduce you to another dead man walking. A condemned criminal who 2,000 years ago, by the grace of God, was crucified on a cross right next to Jesus Christ. He was within earshot of the Son of God. And through this experience with Jesus, this criminal was transformed from a dead man walking into a forgiven man in paradise. This is a longer passage, so you might want to pull out your Bibles to follow along. We're going to be looking at Luke chapter 23. So pause a moment so you can get your Bible out and turn to Luke 23. So now let's start reading with from Luke 23, beginning with verse 32. Two others, both criminals, were led out to be executed with him, with Jesus, when they came to the place called the Skull. It was called the Skull because it was where they commonly did executions. It was also called Golgotha. This wasn't out in the wilderness. This was just steps from the outside of the city of Jerusalem, not far from the center of Jerusalem, where everybody could see. Because remember, the Romans used the crucifixion as a form of terrorism. They wanted people to see the execution so that they would be deterred from rebelling or from coming against the Roman government. And when they came to this place called the Skull, they nailed him to the cross. The criminals were also crucified, one on his right and one on his left. Three crosses. Jesus is in the center, the two criminals on either side. And verse 35 continues. The crowd watched, and the leader scoffed. He saved others, they said. Let him save himself if he really is God's Messiah, the chosen one. And the soldiers mocked him, too, by offering him a drink of sour wine. They called out to him, "If you are the King of the Jews, save yourself!" And a sign was fashioned above him with these words, "This is the King of the Jews." And they meant that sign as a form of mockery. But the irony is, it was true. Jesus is King. Verse 39 continues, one of the criminals hanging beside him scoffs, So you're the Messiah, are you? Prove it by saving yourself and us too while you're at it. This one criminal is going along with the crowd. He's mocking Jesus as well, but then look at the other criminal in verse 40. But the other criminal protested, don't you fear God even when you've been sentenced to die? We deserve to die for our crimes, but this man has done nothing or hasn't done anything wrong. This other criminal is coming to terms with the life that he has lived. He's recognizing his own guilt, but he's also recognizing that Jesus wasn't guilty. And in this moment, he becomes concerned about his eternal destination, whether he's going to heaven or to hell. He's wondering, what's going to happen when I die? We see this in verse 42. Then he said, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. That's incredible. In the last moments of his life, this guy answers probably one of life's most important questions. Who is Jesus? He believes that Jesus is the Messiah, and he asks Jesus, in one of his final breaths, will you take me with you? Will you save me? He asked for salvation. And in verse 43, Jesus replied, I assure you today you will be with me in paradise. Jesus could see into the heart of this dead man walking. And although we don't know everything about this condemned criminal, what we do know is that in this moment, Jesus saw his readiness for salvation. In one moment, in the final moment of his life, this condemned criminal, apart from everything else he's done in his life to that point, received God's salvation. So let's explore what we can learn from this condemned criminal about God's salvation. For some of you, what we're going to learn may be just reminders. And if so, Palm Sunday is the perfect time to be reminded of God's great gift of grace and his salvation that he offers for us. And we can be thankful for that. For others, this could be new ground. As we go to the cross with this condemned criminal, you may discover something today that changes your eternity forever. Just like it did for that condemned criminal on that day. Today, you may realize that if you're living without God in your life, you are a dead man or a dead woman walking. Even though you're still alive, you're moving forward in life towards an eternity that's going to be spent separated from God. Maybe today, for the first time, you'll recognize who Jesus really is, and you'll experience him in a way that you never have before. The first thing that we can learn from this condemned criminal about salvation is that salvation is by grace. Salvation is by grace. The condemned criminals receive salvation through God's grace. And now before we go any further, let's define some of those terms so we can fully appreciate what salvation is, what grace is, and what it all means. So what is salvation? Salvation is simply God's process of forgiving our sins, of adopting us into his family, and securing our eternity in heaven through the death and the resurrection of his son, Jesus Christ. That's salvation. It's God's work. And now when we say salvation by grace, let's understand what grace is. Grace means that we did nothing to earn it. It's all God's doing. We didn't earn it. It's a gift from God. There's a documentary about the first Gulf War in the 1990s, and it's narrated by General Norman Schwarzkopf. Stormy Norman was the general in charge of the first Gulf War, and he was narrating this film, and there was this heartbreaking footage of a bridge right outside of Baghdad that they were getting ready to blow up. And just before the missile arrived, an elderly man on a bicycle could be seen going across the bridge. Knowing that a missile was on the way, all we could do was watch as that old man is going across the bridge on his bicycle. Then just as he gets off the bridge, the missile hits and explodes, and the bridge collapses while the old man escapes unharmed. In the documentary, Schwarzkopf zooms in on the bicyclist and refers to him as the luckiest man in all of Baghdad. There's nothing lucky about war. There's also nothing lucky about crucifixion. And here in our story, this condemned criminal on the cross is crucified right next to Jesus. And he's just like that guy on the bridge in Baghdad. Think about it. Of all the places he could have been crucified, he was crucified on Golgotha, on the Skull Hill, right next to Jesus, the Son of God. Of all the days that he could have been crucified, he was crucified on that first Good Friday, right beside Jesus. Historical records show that crucifixion was a daily occurrence for Romans. The Romans crucified their enemies and criminals in astounding numbers, hundreds and thousands at a time, in order to suppress and to terrorize the people. Understand, there were far more dead men walking in those Roman prisons than those three that were hanging there on Golgotha that morning. More than likely, Jerusalem's prisons were filled with condemned criminals, and of all the days and of all the people, this condemned criminal could have been crucified beside. He was crucified that day right beside Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Some might say he was the luckiest guy in Jerusalem that day, but the truth is it had nothing to do with luck. God had a plan for this criminal on that day. God was going to use him to demonstrate God's grace down through the ages. This criminal on the last day of his life finds himself hanging on the cross right next to Jesus Christ. Remember what Jesus says to him? And Jesus replied, "I assure you today, you will be with me in paradise." Now, why did Jesus say these words to this condemned criminal? Because at the last possible moment, he understood who Jesus is. He realized that that sign that was posted above Jesus' head was true. He was the King of the Jews. Jesus was the promised Messiah. He was the King. This condemned criminal never heard, but I'm sure he would agree with Paul's writing in Romans 5, 7, and 8, which says, "Now most people would not be willing to die for an upright person, though someone might perhaps be willing to die for a person who's especially good. But God showed his great love for us by sending Christ to die for us while we were still sinners." Jesus died for us while we were still sinners. Grace means that God offers us his salvation while we are still sinners. That's what grace is all about. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 and 9 says it this way: "God saved you by his grace when you believed." And you can't take credit for this. It is a gift from God. Salvation is not a reward for the good things we have done, so none of us can boast about it. The condemned criminal teaches us first that God's salvation is by grace, and by grace alone. It's nothing that we do. You know what? That's good news for all of us. From the condemned criminal, we also learn that God's salvation is personal. God's salvation is personal. He offers it to us personally. Salvation, understand this, salvation comes from an individual, Jesus Christ, to an individual, each one of us. It comes directly from Jesus. Here in this instant, to the specific criminal. Notice again how personal it is when, in Jesus' words, "And Jesus replied, I assure you today, you will be with me in paradise." People think that they're a Christian because they come from a Christian country. Some people think if I'm born in a certain family, then I must be a Christian. In response to this, the well-known Christian evangelist Billy Graham once said, "Being born in America makes you no more a Christian than being born in a garage makes you a car. Salvation comes to no one in mass. It comes to everyone personally, individually, intimately. Your parents cannot receive God's salvation for you. Your spouse can't receive God's salvation for you. Your grandparents can't receive God's salvation for you. You must receive it yourself. You must make a personal response by saying yes to God's gift of grace offered through Jesus Christ and receive Him as your Savior and Lord. How do you do that? Romans 10:9 tells us, if you openly declare that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised Him from the dead, you will be saved. So salvation is personal. In review, salvation is by grace, salvation is personal, and then the third truth is that salvation is immediate. Salvation is immediate. Let's look at this from Luke 23:43 again. And Jesus replied, I assure you today, you will be with me in paradise. He tells the condemned criminal today, not tomorrow, not after years of purgatory spent making up for everything you did wrong, not after several reincarnations where you've overcome all those negative things that happened in your life. He says, today. Salvation happens in an instant. It's immediate. He says you don't have to wait for it. It happens the minute you receive Jesus Christ into your life. Acts 2:21 tells us, but everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Salvation is available to everyone. The moment that you call on the name of the Lord, you will be saved. That's what the condemned criminal experienced with Jesus 2,000 years ago. How did he get it? That's our next lesson. God's salvation is immediate, but it also is through Jesus alone. Salvation is through Jesus alone. God's salvation comes only through one person, and that's Jesus Christ. Again, going back to Luke 23:43, it says, and Jesus replied, I assure you today you will be with me in paradise. Jesus, the Messiah, the Son of God, he tells the condemned criminal, he tells this dead man walking, today you're receiving salvation through me. I am giving you salvation. He asked Jesus for salvation, and Jesus gave him salvation through himself. You receive God's salvation through Jesus Christ, or you don't receive it at all. That's why as Christians we make such a big deal about Easter. Today we're at the cross, but next Sunday we're going to be at the tomb, at the empty tomb. This Holy Week between now and then is about Jesus offering salvation to everyone through his death and his resurrection. Jesus is the only one who can offer salvation because he's God's one and only Son. He's the only one who died for our sins and was raised again so that we could be forgiven, so that we could have new life. Jesus said it this way in John 14:6. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one can come to the Father except through me. No one can come to the Father except through me. Now, I want to clarify something about God's salvation through Jesus Christ. Something that critics often raise about Christianity. Jesus never excluded anyone. He didn't exclude the condemned criminal. He didn't exclude Mary Magdalene. He didn't even exclude the Roman soldier who put the spikes in his hands and in his feet. He didn't exclude you, and he didn't exclude me. Jesus never excludes anyone. Jesus says anyone, and he means anyone who wants to experience God's salvation can have it through him. Christianity is by far the most inclusive faith in the world, because it's crystal clear that anyone can receive God's salvation through Jesus Christ. You don't have to earn it. You don't have to be a certain ethnicity. You don't have to be born in a certain country. You don't have to be in a certain societal class or social class. You don't even have to lead a good life until this point. You don't have to wonder, do I have God's salvation? If you receive God's salvation through Jesus Christ, you can know that you know. And you can know it now. The final lesson from the condemned criminals is God's salvation is for eternity. God's salvation is for eternity. Salvation is by grace. It's personal. It's immediate. It's through Jesus alone, but it's also for eternity. It starts with the moment you say yes to Jesus Christ. The salvation that God offers through Jesus doesn't have an expiration date, and God will do everything possible to keep us in relationship with Him, except take away our free will. And as long as we stay in relationship with Him, we are eternally secure. As United Methodists, we believe in eternal security and in the perseverance of the saints, but we don't believe once saved, always saved. We believe that we can fall from grace by our own choices because God doesn't take away our freedom of choice, even though we decided at one time to say yes to His grace. God does everything He can to keep us eternally secure, except take away our free will. God sends the Holy Spirit to live inside of us and to guide us. But we have to be willing to listen. The Holy Spirit is the same power that raised Jesus from the dead and gives us new life as long as we work with Him. The Holy Spirit is also greater than any power in the world. But the Holy Spirit is also a gentleman. He will not force His will on anyone because God doesn't want puppets. He wants willing hearts to follow Him. By His grace, He offers salvation through Jesus Christ. And that offer for salvation is for eternity. The Apostle Paul tells us in Romans 5:17, for the sin of this one man, Adam, caused death to rule over many. But even greater is God's wonderful grace and His gift of righteousness. For all who receive it will live in triumph over sin and death through this one man, Jesus Christ. Jesus offers us salvation. We can triumph over sin. We can be restored to a right relationship with God. And paradise can be ours. Everyone. Even those who have never received salvation, they live for eternity. For those without God's salvation, eternity will be spent without God in a place that the Bible describes as hell, which is the worst place imaginable. Through God's salvation, we can spend eternity with God in heaven. So, do you know who Jesus is? Do you know for sure that if you were to die this very moment, this very day, that you would spend eternity with God in heaven? Do you know that you would hear those words of Jesus, I assure you today you will be with me in paradise? If you never responded to God's grace and said yes to His offer of salvation through Jesus Christ, in many ways you're like that condemned criminal on the cross. You're a dead man or a dead woman walking. You're on your way to an eternity separated from God. In a moment, I'm going to pray, and I'm going to give you an opportunity to receive salvation from Him so you can know for sure, like the condemned criminal did, that you can spend your eternity in paradise. So let us pray. Father, on this Palm Sunday, thank You for what Your Son, Jesus Christ, did on that cross for us. Taking the sins upon Himself, taking our sins to the grave, and then being raised again to overcome the power of sin and death, so that we can experience life with You now and for all eternity. Father, I pray if there's anyone watching today who hasn't trusted in You and responded to Your grace, who's been going life through life apart from You, that today, maybe for the first time, they will recognize who Jesus really is. And they will say yes to you. And that they'll ask you to come in to their life. And they, in their hearts and in their minds, will hear your words. Today, my son, today, my daughter, you will be with me in paradise. Amen and amen. And now, if you have given Jesus your heart over to Jesus today, if you've received that forgiveness for the first time, you can email me or you can text me or you can send that information to me. The information and how to do that is in the description of this worship service. And I pray that you do that. And if you do, I will send you information on how you can walk closer with Jesus and be transformed more and more into what He created you to be.
For me, who calls.
before we close, I want to challenge you to think about the eternity of others who are in your life, the people that you care about. Think about the eternity of your friends, your family, your neighbors, your co-workers, the people in your life who need God's salvation, but who right now don't know Jesus. They might not even know who Jesus is. They don't have a relationship with him. Next Sunday is April 4th, and it's Easter. It's Easter Sunday. It's one of the days of the year that people are open to Christ and to hearing the good news about Jesus. If someone just shares it with them, if someone just invites them to be a part of a service where they can hear that good news, it will not just be sharing the age-old story of the resurrection as we look at, but we're going to be looking at how we can find forgiveness. It's the beginning of a sermon series, because we can't cover forgiveness in just one Sunday, called the Forgiveness, the Real F Word. And forgiveness is the real F word because forgiveness is one of the most powerful forces in the entire universe. Forgiveness is a thing that can restore the relationship between us and God. Forgiveness is the thing that he can heal a broken relationship between me and another person. Forgiveness is also the thing that can help me get rid of some of the baggage from my past. The hurt, the fear, the regret, the shame, all those mistakes. Forgiveness has the power to do all of that. We're going to talk about it during this series. It's also an incredible opportunity for you to invite people in your life who you care about so that they can hear about Jesus next Sunday, watching Tunnel and Warren Chapel during their broadcast. We are going to be having 6 online services on Easter, and the first one starts at 9 a.m. on Sunday, and they're followed by one at 10:30, one at noon, one at 2, one at 4, and one at 6 p.m. So I want you to think about 5 people. 5 people. Got them in your mind? 5 people that you want to share Jesus with. And I encourage you to write them down. Throughout this week, pray for them and also take the opportunity to invite them to be a part of our Easter celebration next week. Let's pray for them right now. Father, we pray for those people in our lives, our friends, our family, our co-workers, our classmates. Maybe the parents of the classmates of our children that we interact with online or in different ways. As we see them bringing and dropping their kids off at school or at school activities. Right now, God, I know you're dropping pictures of faces right in our minds. You're putting names on our hearts and in our minds. God, we may be their only hope to hear the good news. There's no one else in their life who's going to invite them to hear about Jesus except for us. God, open our hearts and give us the opportunity. And when we invite them, God, I pray that they will say yes. I pray for our services next Sunday and that you would work in a powerful way through each one of them. Thank you for your son, Jesus. We love you and we pray this all in his name. Amen and amen. People of God, go from this time into this hard and this holy week. Trust in God. Be filled with the Spirit. Walk with Christ to the end. For Christ's times are in our hands now, as ours have ever been in his. Amen and amen. Thank you.
survey the wondrous cross on which the Prince of Glory died. My riches gained, my soul.